Hallo, auch unsere Abonnenten in Australien und Deutschland, sowie in Großbritannien und Michigan und Philadelphia, Missouri und Dallas, Texas. Heute werden wir über Träume sprechen. I think today we're going to speak about dreams. From the last episode, we spoke about Greeks, ancient Greeks, and we discussed Freud. Mankind has always been curious about dreams, but how do we decipher the symbolic language of dreams, like the symbolic language of the myth? Some people find that discussing their dreams with a therapist or even just with friends can help them unravel the symbols within, and that's what we're doing on Patroma Therapy, right?
Yes. I'm just taking a breath. There's like so much to discuss. And the interpretation of dreams is an activity that many civilizations and peoples have been busy with. And since we have recently been talking about some of the Greek myths of Sisyphus and Prometheus, maybe in the future we'll do Atlas. The Greeks had a god of sleep. Do you know what his name was?
No.
His name was Morpheus. And Morpheus is one of the sons of Hypnos. So Hypnos is Greek, but his Roman name is Somnos. So Morpheus, the god of sleep, sends dreams to people. And that's one way of looking at it. Now, since we're living in modern times, COVID 2020, okay, we are under the influence of one of the founders of dream analysis, Sigmund Freud. And he actually wrote the book, The Interpretation of Dreams. He wrote it in German. He lived in Austria. And we're going to do two episodes on dreams. So for this episode, we're going to kind of talk about some of our dreams. But Freud had this idea that we have this sort of unconscious energy that's swirling around in us, and we sublimate it, or we translate it, or we use defense mechanisms. But we basically have two parts: our conscious self, conscience with knowledge, our waking self. Then there's our unconscious, which means things we're not aware of. So I've studied a little bit about dream interpretation. And when did you first hear about Sigmund Freud?
I don't even remember. It was probably so many years ago, but now I get to hear about them more often because of this lockdown. I'm trying to decode my corona dreams because I'm having unusually vivid dreams actually during this coronavirus lockdown. Are you having more vivid dreams since the lockdown? Because you're not alone, trust me. And I'm trying to understand what they mean. I'm kind of opening like Freud's books, which I have, even switched to Jung from time to time.
Well, I was reading an article last Sunday in the New York Times Magazine, and somebody in Manhattan is collecting COVID dreams. But I have noticed that I'm having more dreams. And also I have a friend that lives in Manhattan, and she was telling me at the beginning of the pandemic, when New York started to shut down, she had a dream of being suffocated by a pillow, that someone was suffocating her with a pillow. So, I have also had some dreams. One of my dreams last night, as I was looking at my phone to see how many subscribers we had. So that's it. It's like, it's an unconscious, unfulfilled, desire. I'm wondering, do we have any subscribers? But you told me, because you're in Moscow and you wake up before me, that you told me that we got a new subscriber. I was so excited.
It's very interesting that you remember how, that you can recall your dreams, because I sometimes, very often, almost always, I don't remember them. One of the main reasons probably that I don't recall them is because the minute I wake up, I just, I don't know, maybe my mind just focuses on the day ahead, and it's always difficult to remember what I had just minutes ago. It seems like a second even, but I don't remember it.
Well, you were telling me that
That one I remembered somehow.
we were telling me that you have a that you spend some time in your car traveling back and forth, commuting to work, and that we talked a little bit about how the roads are kind of like the labyrinth of life. And you were telling me something about that you have some cats, some little cats.
Well, that was not exactly a dream, it was a nightmare. So I have these cats back at my summer residence, and they're almost wild already, and they're always hungry, so I feed them whenever I can. And suddenly I'm having this dream about them wild cats and how I'm feeding them. Only this time there is two more cats next to mine, but these new cats, they are more of domestic kind, you know, with healthy and smooth and shiny fur coat, and not spiky or clumped together, but hungry just the same. And one of these new cats, seeing how my wild cats eat the food I brought, suddenly turns to me, and now that we're discussing it, I remember I was chewing on some piece of grilled meat too, and so this new cat jumps and like kisses me really hard and bites me on the lip. Like, I didn't know what to think about it. That was a nightmare. That's why I call it not a dream.
Okay, but how did you feel in the dream? Like, imagine you're closing your eyes and you're in the dream. Not later, you're telling me now you're out of the dream. You're telling me it was a nightmare. But in the dream, how did it feel to be kissed by this cat?
I can't describe it. It was.
I think you can describe it. I think you're resisting therapy and not describing it.
I don't know, dreams, like, I don't know, maybe I'm resisting the therapy subconsciously.
Unconsciously, you're resisting. And that's why we're here, is to work through your resistances so that you can go back into your car and drive around the streets of Moscow without.
How can I describe the cat kissing without it being weird? It's unnatural for, but it's normal if instead of cat I'd have impossible to get to physical descriptions for the price of one, right?
Wait a minute, you're shuffling now. You're rationalizing, you're kind of gaslighting, you're sidestepping. I'm just saying that you called it a nightmare, but a beautiful cat turning around to kiss you, I would think that you were baffled by it when you woke up. You're calling it a nightmare. A nightmare would be something you're afraid of and you're sweating. Were you like in fear and sweating?
No, I wasn't that in fear at all. I just Googled it immediately. The first minute I woke up, I turned on my laptop and Googled it, and somehow the first answer was that means a new beginning, like I'm reached this spiritual height. And
If a cat kisses you, it's a spiritual high.
well, now when you mentioned it probably said that when you kiss a cat, and didn't say that cat kissed you. I don't remember that.
Okay, was the cat kissing you? Just a minute. Okay, so what we want to do is stay on the inside of the dream. So Freud said that an uninterpreted dream is like an unopened letter. So you have your conscious self right now. You're talking in Petroma therapy, and we're making a little talk show. But in the night, your deep self, your unconscious self, was trying to surface and to give you a message. And then you woke up and you like panicked and opened up Google. So you should not look at Google. You should lay in bed with your eyes closed and see what could that message be.
Maybe I was like some sort of relieving some painful experience from the past.
Are you thinking? Are you feeling? So you're like a hyper thinker, and then your feelings are another part of yourself. So like being a rational man, like we have the Minotaur, his sort of split self. We have Jekyll and Hyde. We have our rational side, the rules of society, how to be a good citizen. Then we have our unconscious desires to eat and sleep and run and play and just be kind of wild. I mean, you seem to be rather intellectual.
Thank you. I'm trying to spot like hidden connection or inconsistency in this dream. I'm trying to understand if it's my cognitive ability to translate something to the waking world, where where I'm probably trying to find a solution to some problem, but I can't. I've never had such dreams before.
Well, I know that a couple weeks ago, you and I had been talking about gambling and about horse racing. And I was telling you that in Texas, not far from Dallas, there is a beautiful Lone Star racetrack. And a friend of mine invited me to go with him to the racetrack, which was kind of interesting because Dallas has been closed down for like 3 months, and for 2 weeks it was open. And going to the racetrack sounded like fun, but I wasn't sure I wanted to do that. Then I also remembered a couple of years ago I had gone with this same friend, David, up to Oklahoma to do some gambling. So the dream takes some bits from our waking life, the racetrack. You and I were talking about the racetrack. I did go on a trip to Oklahoma. In Oklahoma, they have casinos and gambling are legal. And I was super excited that I wanted to play like Russian roulette. And then David wanted to play blackjack. So we stood at the blackjack tables for about an hour and a half, and David made $1,500. And I just stuffed the cash in my jacket, and we drove back to Dallas in the ice. It was an ice storm, and we went during an ice storm. So these elements that I had from my waking life, very recently, about a week ago, I dreamed. I'm in the dream, and I'm driving along the coast of Monaco, and I'm wearing like a black scarf. I have sunglasses. My scarf is trailing in the wind. I have little pearl earrings on, and I had this sensation that you were sitting next to me, my co-therapist, and you were driving, and you had one hand, one elbow on, the side of the car because it was a drop top. It was a convertible. Little convertible, maybe like a Austin Healey Sprite or some kind of a cool little convertible. It was cream colored and it had a black drop top, and you had kind of some kind of driving cap on, and you were talking. And I remember just glancing over. I don't remember seeing you, but I remember glancing over and telling you, could you please stop talking and just keep your eyes on the road?
You mentioned the casino. I was like waiting if you made a bet and won $1 million or something like that.
Well, see, some people say that you need to go back into your dream and try to finish the dream. So some therapists say that you should keep a journal next to your bed, even if you can just catch the tail end of a dream, a little bit of a dream, write a little bit. So like maybe I would try to go back into that dream.
Maybe that's the way to harness the hidden power of your dream.
Well, if a dream is a letter to yourself and you don't read it, I would say if I'm going to read that letter, I would say that I'm going on a journey with you, which could be like Petroma therapy, and I'm worried that you are going to get off the road, maybe off track.
You said that that's a letter to yourself. A dream is a letter to yourself. I think dreams are a glimpse into the higher realms of the non-physical universe, maybe.
Yeah, it's a connection. It's like a pathway to a parallel universe.
Exactly, where everything is controlled by thought and you are the creator of it.
Well, you are the one having the dream, so you are conscious. Some people are aware when they're dreaming. Like some people, for example, when I had the dream of driving along the road in Monaco, you were driving, but I had an awareness that I was both the woman in the passenger seat, and then there was like a higher self observing us from above. So I was aware that I was dreaming. So that's called lucid dreaming or conscious dreaming. I was aware that I was dreaming. Now, when you had the dream about the cat turning around, were you the man in the dream, or was there another third perspective?
I was myself, and that was the one-time thing. On the other side, I have this recurring dream where I'm always being late for my diploma exam in the university. I don't know why. Or there's another one when I'm being chased.
Okay, wait a minute. We gotta go slower. So I want you just to tell the dream slowly, like, I'm at the university. I'm going into the auditorium. I'm running down the hall. Just tell it in the first person. I pretend that you're.
Okay, I have this recurring dream where I'm about to graduate from the university, but then I suddenly remember I haven't completed this one coursework, and because of that, I will not be allowed, I never remember the details exactly. Something about wandering the halls in panic. And I got my diploma 20 years ago. I don't know why I'm even getting these dreams.
Okay, we gotta go slower. We gotta go slower. Okay, so on our cover shot, we see a picture from a painting by Marc Chagall. So let's pretend like that's a dream, just like your dream of running down the hall to go to a graduation that you're late and there's like fear and panic. Maybe there would be like a long hall. So in this painting, we see Marc Chagall has painted a woman floating over a little city. And it is the painting is a famous surrealist painting, and he was actually a Russian Jew who lived on the border of Russia and I believe Belarus. And so he found some fulfillment in his painting. So what if you painted this dream or sketched it out like, and it would be called I'm Late to the Ceremony. What would it be called if you were painting the dream of being late to graduation?
I don't think you can put a name on that.
Well, you have to because we're in therapy. Pretend that you're going to paint this dream that you don't understand, and it's called Late to Graduation. Tell me three things that would be in it.
Well, maybe there was a clock, or maybe there was an F mark for the exam, and maybe there was my friends. I don't know. I haven't paid much attention to such details, and this dream is one of the few I haven't been able to forget at all. And I'm telling you, I would rather forget it than.
Okay, let's pause a second. Okay, just pause. Just take a deep breath. So Freud used a technique with his patients. He was actually a doctor who started studying about the mind, and he used free association. So what I just did with you was some free association. I stopped your spinning in your head about all this stuff, and I said, just give me three objects. And then you took a deep breath and you go, there's a clock. There's the F mark on the exam, and then there's my friends. So, what would you say the clock represents? Time, the march of time, right? And what do your friends represent?
You tell me.
Other people that observe you. And what does the F mean? Well, I know what the F means. Yeah, you have failed in some ways.
That's what bothers me.
Now, see, the thing is, it with Petroma therapy. You're not a therapist. I'm not a therapist. We're kind of having a talk show, but we just hope that as we do these discussions, that our subscribers will make some comments. Maybe you'll get some insights. I'll get some insights. I mean, I didn't realize until I was talking to you about my road trip, our road trip along the coast of Monaco, that I was complaining to you that you were talking too much. That's actually something I do, and that's called projection. What I can't accept in myself, I project onto another person. So I tend to talk a lot, but I blamed you. Like, stop talking so much and just keep your eyes on the road. So I actually got something out of our little session today. Thank you, Mr. Therapist, Mr. Co-therapist.
Well, that sounds like a closing line, but every ending means new beginnings, so maybe we'll discuss it in the episode 2.
That sounds great. Adios for now. Auf Wiedersehen.